Penguin Random House Canada presents Pure Life, or Rip Blue Tide X Lucky Smash Zero Naked Grace, Sit, Go! By Eugene Marten. Read for you by Tim Perez. For Kelly, and to the memory of my parents. How super it must feel to achieve your biggest thrill as an athlete on the last day of your life. To know the perfection of the body, even as your skin loses heat and energy and hair and nails, and now we're all enfolded in your arms. You are the culture that contains us. We're running out of time, so tell us quickly. Time is short. Tell us now. Don DeLillo, the rapture of the athlete assumed into heaven. About 5% of love is romantic. The other 95% is something else. Steve Young, number 8, QB, my life behind the spiral. Piyuta yamuka man, kiyama larida man, tatankuman kan, takbi, prak, priam. Mosquito healing song. This is not yet the time of girls. It is a time of fields, diamonds, quartz, fake leather, vacant lots in asphalt, broken glass, and blood. It is Sunday afternoon in early autumn on the front lawn of a public school. Time to pick up a game, choose sides, 5-on-5, the sidewalk out of bounds. The other border is a long hedge behind which boys go to pee, play with matches, learn to smoke, drink, sniff, abuse small animals, and sometimes each other, under the blind windows. The boy whose ball it is hikes to himself, backpedals in the dirt. His brother stands in front of him, arms raised, counting 1-1,000, 2-1,000. Sometimes he counts battleships. Now here he comes. Street lights flicker. It is officially dark, a school night. Boys have algebra, state capitals, late mass. Boys have baths. Now it is 4-on-4, now 3-on-3. Across the street, the mother of twins sings her son's home. Joey, Eddie! Eddie, Joey! 2-on-2, then 1-on-1, brother on brother, each trying to catch his own throw. But the boy the ball belongs to is the boy who belongs to the ball. He is shy, quiet, a bedwetter, good with numbers, goes to confession, an altar boy, but a mother's boy with no mercy. Even when it is touch, he tackles. An argument, blows, tears. Now he plays alone, throwing and running against no one, against himself, against the dark, against all. Drags a garbage can into the middle of the field, throws to what only he can see. Coach tells his kids, "You must choose the pain of discipline or the pain of regret." His assistant nods. The oldest boy is 12. They start with the three-point stance. Those who pick it up fast go on to snap drills. Some become centers. Some don't pick it up at all. The grass, unmarked, is fresh cut and smells like the end of summer. Then there are sprints, bear crawls, tumbling drills to see who has feet. He is the oldest kid there, but slow and skinny. He doesn't have feet. They set up passing squares in the diamond. He stands on the pitcher's mound again, though Little League was months ago. Four receivers run around the bases, and he throws to each as they cut around the bags. The assistant is paunchy, pasty, roomy-eyed. Calls him Snake because he's left-handed like number 12. Just hit their hands. They don't even have to catch it. He is 4-for-4, his first time out. Then the runners change direction, and he's 8-for-8. The assistant's hand on his back, boneless, like a leech. First day in pads, big-headed in helmets. They learn to sweat, hit, how not to cry, vomit behind the ash tree that shades their parents at the edge of the grass. Coach keeps them thirsty. When their mothers aren't there, he speaks to them in the language of men, the language he used at the slab mill, where he was a cinder man, where he ate carbon dust and iron like everyone else in the valley. But if you ask him, he'll tell you this is his real job. "Fire out, fire out," he says. "Good group, good group," says everything twice. The boys bark like dogs. When their mothers aren't there, some of them have no ride home. The assistant beeps his horn, but the one he called Snake rides his bike. He has his number now. Black Monday, A father arrives at Sheeton 2, the Campbell Works, to find a sign taped to doors now chained shut. He and 5,000 men and women turn around and go home or to the scores of bars that line the valley, and whose days are also numbered. He will not be the same. Some fight back, but 2 years later, the Brayer Hill Works blast furnaces named Grace and Jeanette close. Then U.S. Steel's Ohio Works, then Hazleton, then Sharon Steel. Unemployment in Y-Town rises to 24%, and a building a day burns down in the valley. Insurance the only income for those who must walk away from homes and businesses. Arsonists pay off the fire departments. Homecoming. After the game, reassuringly sore, pain is still a privilege, a token of accomplishment. Number 19 moves, in another way, under a different kind of light with the captain of the majorettes. His vest matches her ball gown, and though they are not in the court, both decline nominations to make room for the less popular, the unattractive, disabled, bullied minority, a practice that has yet to establish itself. They are the true king and queen of the evening. Their corner of the gym is center, and to almost everyone. But in truth, he is uncomfortable in popularity, as he is in this rented tuxedo, and declined the nomination for class presidency for somewhat the same reason, though also so he could focus on game tape and defensive alignments, and on English, social studies, his academic weaknesses. In truth, a bit of a bore, shy with girls, good at math, drinks ginger ale at the parties he attends mainly for solidarity, fellowship of the varsity jacket, has a close friend somewhere out there among the absent and excluded who isn't a jock, whom he has defended against his own teammates, all of which is forgiven because he threw for 5 scores and put up nearly 400 yards tonight, and is starting quarterback for a high school in the middle of America. He vomits before every game. But if it is true that he is shy with them, kind of skinny and geeky around them, gangling, purportedly saving himself for marriage, though, with his dark eyes and curls and aquiline nose, on the verge of looking the part he has played tonight, it is also true that it doesn't matter, that they come to him, as the captain of the majorettes came, though perhaps in part because it was expected of her, and they believe they are in love, perhaps in part because it is expected, though perhaps he is truly in love with only one thing. The DJ conjures Sade, smoking velvet. 19 drops his hand to the small of her back, perfecting the embrace. Deep sea slow. Streamers and balloons, colors bending over the polished wood floor and walls, over teachers relegated to chaperone watching, policing, perhaps seeing themselves among the watched, recalling the cologne, the hair, the hush, the sway, the groping as for beauty just out of reach, the yet unbroken promise of it all, maybe as good as it got. The king has cerebral palsy, dances knock-kneed with his mother at half-court. The captain of the majorettes looks up suddenly, not at 19 but over his shoulder, as if into her future, community college, where futures begin, name registered, then tucks her blonde head under his chin, makes a memory, and he looks over it to another uncrowned queen on the other side of the gym. No escort, no makeup, nor need of it, neither cheerleader nor majorette, but a fair gymnast, probable valedictorian, and foremost a violinist, bound for some school without an athletic program. We think we want what we already have. He turns away. Sees number 47, looking around as if for a better party, a fight to break up or begin. Prematurely thinning, wearing the same full beard since 9th grade, probably too small for college, though not for the girl he is dancing with, not saving himself for anything. Sees 36 and 74, with whom he has visited nursing homes and soup kitchens at coach's behest. Coach in his tight suit and crew cut, lump in his chin, who has taught him humility as well as 6 different drops, that there is throwing and there is passing, that your eyes are more important than your arm, that there can be honor in losing, but no winning without honor, and everything else is just kicking stones. 19 believes in almost all of it. I can't believe you drove all that way in this weather, his mother marvels at the Lightning's coach. The family sits in the family room, on the same furniture in the same duplex his parents moved into the day they married. You can smell it. You can hear the neighbor's TV on the other side of the wall. School jet can't fly in a snowstorm, his father says. The coach smiles. His nose is red bulbous. You must be thinking of Alabama. Made 60 some recruiting flights in 6 months.
Right. I forgot. You're D2.
His brother and sister smirk. It's just a number. There's nothing your son can get out of one of those programs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.